going to have the midterm examination on next Saturday, and I think it's supposed to start by reviewing what you guys gonna have in the midterm examination. So coming for the review, okay, in the moment this distribution, the step of calculation analysis of the beam and the frame width size where the step are fixed. Usually we will start by consider the beam in the problem statement. And for some time I have talking about how to find the degree of indeterminacy. You guys can see this is a roller, this is a roller, this also the roller, and this is the pin. So this one supposed to have 2, 3, 4, 5 unknown. And then you have one free body diagram. So this beam is statically indeterminate beam with 2 degrees of indeterminacy. And if you may check for the degree of freedom, since the support A, B, and C are roller and these pins, so you have theta sub A, theta sub B, theta sub C, and also theta sub D, total of 4 degrees of freedom. And then from the first step, you may consider to find the K factor. The name of the K factor is going to be member stiffness factor. So we first find the K factor. And based upon this, when you have the pin end like this one, and you also have the roller like this one, you may use the K to be 3EI over L. However, you're supposed to read the file line over here. Okay. This I sub AB has 3EI. I sub BC has 3EI. However, I sub CD has only 2EI. So, based upon this, your K sub AB, since this one has the lower end, it's going to be 3, and then time 3EI, and divided by the length of 3. So the K sub AB has the K factor of 3EI, okay? And then for the BC, BC is the internal member of this beam. K sub BC is going to be 4 times the stiffness, 3EI, and then divided by, okay, sorry, the length is 3. Basis on this, this is 6, this is 3. So this portion has the length of 3 meters. So you have this one for 4EI. And then the last one is the CD. CD, similar to the AB, it has the pin far end. So K sub CD is gonna be 3. And then have the stiffness of 2EI. And then the length is going to be 4. So this one is 1.5EI. See? And then after you find the stiffness, you will find the distribution factor. Next, you compute for the distribution factor or the DF. And based upon this again, you're going to have the total of 6 df. However, for a quick look, this is going to be df a b, and this one is what? It's the roller. So the df for the roller is going to be 1.0, okay? And then next is going to be df ba. Now df ba you determine by k sub a b divided by k sub a b plus the k sub b c, and basis upon what we have is going to be 3 ei divided by 3 ei and plus 4 ei. Okay, so it's going to be 3/7, and you should get it to be 0.4286. okay, and next, when you determine this one, the df b c is going to be 1 minus the df b a, because the summation of them is 1. Okay, when you know the df sub ba, you will have 1 minus 0.4286. that's going to be 0.5714. the sum of them is 1.0. okay, and then this one is going to be dfcb, and dfcb is going to be k sub bc divided by k sub bc plus k sub cd. okay, and then you have this one for what? For 4 ei, and then divided by 4 ei plus 1.5 ei, and then it's going to be 4, and this one 5.5, and it's going to be 0.7273. and the last one, no, not the last one, this one is here, before the last one is here. Df for the cd, so it's just 1 minus 0.7273. you will get this one to be 0.2727, and the last one is going to be df for dc, since they are hin and lower end. Okay, so just put this one to be 1.0, and yes, which one? The bottom one, right? That's going to be okay. I can move here. Okay, and then this is going to be what? 1.0, because the lower end and the pin end, and then you get this one for 0.4242286, and another one is 0.5714, and this one is going to be 0.7273, and this one 0.2727. just fill the distribution factor into the table. I will provide you the table in the examination. Okay, just follow what I provide you. And then the third, you find the fixed end moment, which is required for the start of our moment distribution. And you may see for the AB, you get the roller and the fix over here. That is for the A and B. And another one in the middle span, that is going to be fixed, okay? And you're supposed to be able to remember the equation. For the first one, AB, we're going to have this one for fixed end moment BA. And this one supposed to be WL squared divided by what? By this one, F.
By
F. And you will get this one to be, let me put it into 20. Okay, it's going to be 20 times T squared, the L, and divided by 8, you're supposed to get it to be 22.5 kilonewton meter. And you see, this is a clockwise, right? This is clockwise. When it's clockwise, this one going to be positive. So you got this one, 22.5. And then for this portion of the BC, you will get this one and this one as the fixed end moment BC equal to the fixed end moment CB. And they are WL squared divided by 12. Okay, and it's going to be 20 times 3 squared divided by 12. That is going to be 15 kilonewton meter. And then this is counterclockwise. This is clockwise. This is going to be negative. So minus 15 for the BC. For the CB, it's going to be positive 15. And that's all for the fixed end moment. And the next step, we just move over here. We perform moment distribution. Okay, so we do the moment distribution. What we have is we come over here, and again, we just consider each part pocket. Let's say at the joint A, this is going to be in equilibrium by itself. However, for the joint B, the moment, the blue and the black moment, they are not equal. We require to have negative of 7.5. Where the negative 7.5 come from, you just times it by distribution factor. You get this. You just multiply it minus 7.5 by this distribution factor. You're supposed to get this one to be 3.214. And next, you're supposed to get it, just take 7.5 and minus 3.214. Okay, that's going to be the easiest way. You're supposed to get it into 4.286. Make sure the sum of them must be zero. Okay, make very sure on that. And then come to this one. This one require negative 15, right? Where the negative 15 come from is come from distribution factor here. So you multiply it, you're going to get 10.910. And then you subtract 15 by 10.910. You're supposed to get negative 4.090. Make sure the sum of them to be zero. Okay, and then this one, you get it in equilibrium by itself. And then when you finish distribution of the moment and the joy. The joy is in equilibrium. The joy C also in equilibrium. Then you got to do the carry over. You got to carry over. However, you cannot carry over from this one to the pin end because the pin is won't take any moment. Okay, because the sum of the moment at the pin to be zero. Okay, and then only this portion can do the carry over. This one cannot occur because this is pin. Okay, and this is zero, nothing at pin. This one, what this is pin. Okay, won't take any moment. That's why we have only these two. So that's going to be half of this minus 5.455. And this is going to be half of this minus 2.143. Now you move your moment equilibrium to point B. You don't need to consider the A and the D, okay? Because there is no moment occur at D, the pin. There is no moment occur at A because it is the roller. And then you require what? You require positive 5.455. That's come from this one, 5.455 times 0.4286. You get 2.338. And for this one, just subtract it from 5.455. You get 3.117. Make sure the sum of them is zero. That's important. And then you require positive 2.143. And then if you time this one, it's going to be 1.559. And this one will be subtracted 0.584. So you finish the second half of moment distribution, and you can see the value of the moment reduce, okay, quite significantly. And then you do again, half of this one will be plus 0.780, and also this one plus 1.558. And after you do the carryover moment, you get this moment distribution. And let me put the number into it. That is going to be negative to make the joint in equilibrium. And this one also negative. You get this one 0.334 and 0.446. The sum of them is zero. And this one will be minus 1.1133. And this one 0.425. And at the last step, you do the carryover moment. You get this one, half of this 0.567. And this one 0.223. Okay, and for the last one, it's going to be the distribution of this moment to make it to be in equilibrium, negative. Okay, require positive to balance it. So this one 0.243, you time it with this one, and then you subtract it from here, 0.324. And then you require positive 0.223 times this one, you get 0.162. This one 0.061. The fixed end moment reduced from this value to this small value. Let's finish. Okay, let's stop the moment distribution here. You just do the summation. Since this one is lower, this one is pin. Okay, the magnitude of the moment must be zero. And for sure, whatever you get for these two moments, they must be equal, right? They must be equal because it's required the equilibrium of the moment at point B. So we get this one, 21.533. This one minus 21.533. Make sure they are in equilibrium. And the last one, you get this one positive 3.870 minus 3.870. And on the last step, you got to the what? The free body diagram of your beam, and you just hug this one A, B, and let me move it a little bit to this portion. Okay, you require only this portion, and then B, C. This one, C, D. Just put the load over here, and then you got to take everything from here. This is 31.533 is positive. So this one M sub B A, this one M sub B A, and then this one must be 21.533 kilonewton meter. Again, this one also must be in equilibrium, and the moment over here positive. And this one is negative, is 3.870 kilonewton meter. So after this, the process to draw the shear diagram, moment diagram, you just follow the engine static, and that's it. Okay. And for somehow, if I just change the problem a little bit, let's see, it's maybe change from the pin to the fix, okay? Or may change from the roller to the fix. There are three types of them. Pin, roller, as we discussed in this problem, okay? And it's maybe fix, okay? And the last one is maybe just this one. And let me show you. I may go pretty fast, but don't worry. I will take the picture of this for you guys later. I like you see what's going to be the difference if I just change this one to be fixed support. What happened is now TEI, 3EI, 2EI, they are the same. On the first step, when you 5K factor, now this one is going to be the same, right? It's going to be K sub A, B, still 3 times 3EI over 3. So this is 3EI. And then how about this one? Yep. K sub BC is going to be the same, 4 times 3EI divided by 3. That is going to be 4EI. However, for the last one over here, UK sub CD must change. UK sub CD must be 4 times 2EI and divided by the L of 4. So this one change from 1.5 to 2EI, okay? And since this k change, okay, sum of the distribution factor need to be changed accordingly. So the second step, we find distribution factor, okay, and then we get distribution factor the same as before, since this is pin. However, this one change from the pin to the fix. So you get df for ab equal to 1.0, since this is pin. Df for dc is going to be 0 because it is fixed, okay? And then for the BA, df for BA is going to be over here. And again, it's going to be K sub AB divided by K sub AB plus over here, K sub BC. And then since this one and this one is the same, it's going to be 3EI over 3EI plus 4EI. That is going to be the same number, 3 over 7. You may take this one to be 0.4286. And DFBC is going to be 1 minus 0.4286. And you get the same O number of 0.5714. Then thing change, okay, for the next step, when you determine K sub CB, for K sub CB is over here. Now, this is going to be K sub BC divided by K sub BC plus K sub CD. Since the value over here is changed, it's going to be 4EI divided by 4EI plus this one, 2EI. Now, this one changed to 0.6667. Okay, the distribution factor just changed to 667. And then, this is not K, DF. DF for the last one over here, DFCD. So 1 minus 0.667, you get this one to be 0.3333. So this one, 3333. Okay, just a note on this one. I would like to you concentrate on the principle. The problem can change to anything, but the principle supposed to be the same. Okay, and then you find the fixed end moment, you will get the same fixed end moment as before. Okay, you get the same one. That is going to be 22.5 plus 22.5. This is the same. And this one minus 15. This one positive 15. I like you guys do some practice on this. And I just like to show you the end result of this. This is supposed to be 0 because it's lower. However, this one will be minus 2.381. And this one, 24.541 minus 24.541. And this is 4.684. And this is minus 4.684. If you may notice, the problem that I'm show you guys over here is come from what I post in the extra example, okay, in the Facebook group. And I just make a change on this one, and finally, if you compare the result that you get, it's going to be changed in accordance with what you change the support. Okay, I will post this the picture of this problem to you guys later, and have some practice on this. Okay, and I should move to the second one. Let me move you guys to the frame besides way. Let's just review a little bit on this problem again. If you may notice, under the wind load applied over here, you guys may know that the deformation of the structure must be something like this. And then over here, the normal angle over here must be the normal angle. Okay, and then the deformation of the frame supposed to be similar to this. And then you get the degree of freedom to be theta C, theta D, and delta. And you supposed to be note that the size way at C and the size way at D, they are equal since no axial deformation occur in the beam and column, if you like to provide your lesson on this. Okay, there is no deformation. And then you should mention something about the moment distribution method when it's developed. The method won't include the size way. Since the method won't include the size way, you must modify the calculation of this frame. Just mention about the principle of superposition. Since we cannot do the direct calculation basis upon this, by the principle of superposition, okay, we separate, okay, the frame into two cases. Now, by this kind of reasoning, we just draw this one equal to, one is the frame here, another one over here is 5.55 meters. So make the frame to be just 1 inch here, and this one for the column. Now we must first prevent the frame from the size way. So on the first frame, under the application of the wind load, we just put the roller over here. So this one is the frame without size way. That's why we don't need to have the no size way frame problem in examination. It's already here. And then this one must plus. This one occurred due to the 3 kilonewton per meter. Okay, and consider the frame with no size way. For the second one, the beam has no size way. So only the size way of the column occur. And since we don't know delta, okay, the exact value of it is the unknown. So the fixed end moment also be our unknown. I supposed to move my over here. Okay, we don't know. Okay, so on the second case, is a must. You may assume the delta, or you may assume the fixed end moment. For the, let me recall back. For the column, if you move it like this, if it's fixed by the delta, you're going to produce the fixed end moment. That is going to be 6 EI delta divided by L square, the length square. So by this consideration, it's up to you. You may assume delta, but if you assume delta, you got to do the calculation to get the fixed end moment for moment distribution. So if you read the textbook, they recommend you to assume the fixed end moment. Okay, and most of the time in the examination, I will provide you with this value. So this is fixed end moment A, B. This is fixed end moment B, A. This, sorry, not B, A, this is A, C. A and C. This is going to be C, A. And this is going to be B, D. And this is fixed end moment D, B. Okay. And if this one is 100 kilonewton meter, I will provide you with this value. Okay. And then after you do the moment distribution, you will get M super naught. Okay. And by this one, it take you to determine the resistance force R. So you will get this one to be R. And this R supposed to put over here. But anyway, we cannot find R directly since we assume fixed end moment. So we call this R prime. Based upon this, we got the end moment M prime, and this M prime take us to the R prime. And based upon principle of superposition, zero equal to this one R, the arrow to the right, minus R prime. Since R prime come from the assumed fixed end moment, so you have the correction factor C. Now, C is gonna be R divided by R prime. And then you make the correction of this. This one going to change, sorry, this one going to change to C M prime. By this correction, the M here is going to be equal to this M and plus C M prime. And then in the calculation, I will provide you guys nearly everything. For example, this is going to be the M prime. Okay. You do the first moment distribution. And then after I provide you, this is counterclockwise. Okay. This is fixed end moment AC. So after this one, this is going to be minus 100. This one fixed end moment CA. This is CA. This is going to be minus 100. And this is BD minus 100. This is what? DB minus 100. Okay. You may have this one for the second one, and then after you do it, you get this M harm. There's supposed to be M harm over here, and the calculation step going to be involved a lot of thing. Let me start first. The second step, you find K factor. The K factor will be the same for the first and the second moment distribution. So our K factor, K sub AB, sorry, AC, that is gonna be 4EI. This is constant EI divided by 5. Okay. And then K sub CD is also K 4EI divided by 5. And the last one, K sub BD, you get it to be 4EI divided by 5. They all equal. And the second step is going to be 5DF, the same as before. And you may just mention DF at this point, and at this point, DFAC equal to DFBD equal to what? Zero, right? Zero. Zero. Since they are fixed support. Okay, so just put this one zero. Just put this one zero. Now you go for the first case of this. Third, you find fixed end moment. And based upon this, you have only the column AC subjected to the wind load. Okay, and this is 3 kilonewton per meter. You fix at C and at A. And again, the deformation of this column must be in this shape, and the fixed end moment AC, and over here, fixed end moment CA, they are equal. And this is WL square over 12. And if you put it, it's gonna be 3 times the length. If you go over here, that is 5 meters. 5 squared over 12. You got to get this one to be 6.25 kilonewton meter. And this is what? This is clockwise. So fixed end moment CA is going to be positive. That is going to be plus 6.25. Fixed end moment AC, this is counterclockwise, minus 6.25. And the author, they has no external loading. Fixed end moment is zero, right? And then just put what we have, this one, oh, sorry, I forgot about distribution factor CA. This, since they are equal, K sub AC divided by K sub AC plus K sub CD. You can see, since they are equal, that is going to be 0.5. And that's going to be equal to DFCD, equal to DFDC, equal to DF DB, whenever the K, all the K are equal, you will get the distribution factor to be 0.5 all of them. And that's going to be very convenient. in distribution of the moment. So now this one require plus 6.25, but 6.25 times 0, this is 0. This joint fixed end is in equilibrium. And now you do the same thing. This one will be what? 6.25 negative times 0.5, 3.125. This is 3.125. And the other, don't worry, this is in equilibrium, the B also. And then you do the same thing. But this time, unlike the previous one, carry over moment, since this one is fixed, okay, it must has carry over moment. Unlike the first one we don't have, because it's the lower. And then this one could be minus 1.562, and this one 0, and this one 0, minus 1.562. You do the same calculation until you reach the end of this to be minus 7.91, and this one plus 2.918. If you get this one 2.918, the author must be minus 2.918. Make sure on this, because the moment at a joint must be equal. Okay, must be equal, Virgo. Just take one and the author, if you sure, just put them to be equal. And then for this one, minus 0.829. The author, you just do it by yourself, because it's going to take a lot of time if I do everything. Okay. And this one going to be plus 0.829. And they must be equal. And the last one, plus 0.414. Plus 0.414. Now, you arrive at M sub naught. Okay. You guys need to determine the R. And this is upon what we get over here. Let me zoom out a little bit. We step number 4, we find R. If you like to determine R, you got to draw the free body diagram. And this frame, the same as this one, subjected to the wind load. And what you are looking for is the force R here, okay? Before you can determine the R here, it's a must for you to determine A sub X, and also this one for B sub X. And I don't know yet, I didn't put the arrowhead into it. And then this one for this portion, we looking for the A sub X, and then what we have is the free body diagram, okay? And this minus 7.91 does occur over here. Since it's minus 7.91, so it's going to be over here, 7.91. This one positive, 2.918, okay? And you like to find this summation. This is the point C, moment at C equal to 0, okay? And then you get A sub X times 5 meters over here, plus 2.918 minus 7.91, and this one 3 times 5 and times 2.5 equal to 0. That's require a lot of calculation. You're supposed to get this one to be 8.498. This is 8.498 kilonewton. And then you have another column over here. Just take it. This is going to be dB. And you use this one. This 8, this 0.829 is over here and it is positive. So this one 0.829 and this one also positive 0.414. And since you have the what clockwise, so this one gonna be B sub X. And B sub X now in this direction. Okay, and you can see if you take the moment over here, it's going to be the sum of the moment divided by 5 meters. You're gonna get it to be 0.414 kilonewton. Okay, you may use the summation of the moment at D equal to 0. So B sub X times 5 is going to equal to 0.829 plus 0.414. Okay, you just sum them divided by 5, you get this one. And then you get B sub X 0.... this is not correct. What you get? This one, sum this one divided by 5. 0.6215. Okay, so this is 0.62. This one is going to be 8.50. And then for summation of X sub X equal to 0, this one is going to be our R. R is in this direction plus 8.498 in the same direction minus this one 3 times 5 and minus 0.6215 equal to 0. So you get the R equal to 7.123 kilonewton. This is what you have for this R. Okay. And you do the same thing for the second moment distribution. However, for this time, you're looking for the R harm over here. Yes. Which one? Zero point what? You mean the BX? 0.829 plus 414 divided by, yep. It's going to be smallest, right? Again, 0.2486. Okay. Oh, you divide by 5, right? Okay. And then you do the same thing. This one supposed to change to 0.2486, right? And then this just check. Anyway, you do like this for the next one, and you will get the M palm, R palm, and then find the correction factor and combine them by follow what we have. I think I have this example from, but it's in Thai 2 years ago. Okay, if you do like that, just follow the step what we have. I don't have much time for this review. I spent an hour on this. So just go back and try to, I think I do a mistake on this. If I got toy 6-2, it's not correct. Point 8 to 9 plus 0.414 and then divided by 5. Yes, you collect 0.2486 and then go ahead and try to check the result. They are supposed to be what? That's 6.75, right? 7506. No, it's not, it's going to be 6. 7506, like this. Anyway, just do, just mean my solution may be wrong. Okay. So finally, when you get the R, let me put it over here so you guys can check it later. I got the R palm to be 56.0 kilonewton. Okay. And then if you know the R palm, and since my R is wrong, so the C I have here is wrong. So the solution is not good. Anyway, that's all for the moment distribution, at least for you guys to have a chance to review for next examination. Third, the third midterm examination supposed to be on September 20, and based upon the university schedule, okay? And then on that 2 hours, you're gonna have 3 problems to work on. The first one is require you a lot of calculation. You must draw the inference line diagram, but this time, for the statically indeterminate beam. Okay, in the theory of structure, we have the inference line diagram for statically determinate. On the statically determinate, the problem is quite easy because based on, if you recall, principle of Muller and Bessler principle, you're going to get the diagram, and those diagram is the linear or the straight line. Unlike this one, the inference line diagram for the statically indeterminate beam, most of them are curved, okay, not a straight line. So in the calculation, it requires you to do a lot of things. I will review it, okay, following this slide. And you got to find the inference line equation that I said is not a straight line, it's gonna be a curved line. From the second one, you should be able to what's so called, I will give you the inference line diagram, both the coordinate and the equation. I mean, I provide you the example for the first objective. Now, why I do that? Because if I decide a problem, draw the inference line, and then do the second one, put the load pattern. If you do the first one wrong, the second will be wrong. So I just separate this thing independently. So if you do wrong in the first problem, you still have a chance to do correct in the second one. You understand what I'm saying, right? So to make thing independent from each other, so you can work maybe better than, okay, connect two problems together. On the second one, I will provide you the inference line equation. And now you should be able to find the load pattern. Okay, I will review this later. And then from that load pattern, I will ask you to determine the reaction, the shear force, the bending moment. That is for actually, you must draw the shear diagram, the moment diagram to determine the maximum shear force and maximum bending moment. And the third one, supposed to be the easiest one, you must be able to draft. You use the Muller-Bessler principle, draft the inference line diagram, and just put the load pattern for the given given inference line diagram, and I will show you for the third one. The third one is supposed to be the easiest one. Okay, and this one supposed to be the middle, and this one require you a lot of computation. And there are only three homeworks problem that's take from my book. Now we come to the definition of the inference line diagram. As you know, is the diagram that show the changing in the function. Function of what? Function of the reaction, function of the shear, or function of the moment at a given point. For example, if you interested in the welding at this A, you're going to put the load, okay, maybe start here, move kit, and move kit, and move kit, and move kit, and move kit. By moving the load, the shear force and the moment at B will change, and then you can determine the maximum effects that occur on point A. Or a simple one, you may think about you have the beam put on your finger, and you may ask your friend to move the load according to this one, and you may feel from the load that transfer to your left and right hand, it will change. And you may also may imagine about a bridge. When the car passing to the bridge, and you set up, for example, at the support A, and when the car far away from support A, the reaction is small. When the car move close to support A, the reaction must be get larger to the largest. Okay, and then the same thing occur over here. Not only the welding point, you may thinking about the reaction, okay, that occur on the support of this beam. Since this beam is statically determined, the picture show over here, you can use the inference line diagram of the tree of structure to work on kit. And let me move kit a little bit to this one. You may go to F4 building, and that is the steel frame over there. And if you consider this one is the beam that's supporting the load over here,
Okay.
This one will similar to what we have from this one. Just only the crane, the 50 kilonewton can move along the length of the beam. And this is statically determinate. So you can analyze this beam based on the theory of structure. However, if you consider the beam over here, by using this one, the red crane will move along this light blue beam. This light blue beam can be assumed to be pinned lower, lower, and lower. So the light blue is going to be statically indeterminate beam with 2 degrees of indeterminacy. That means what? For this frame, it requires you to use the knowledge from the theory of structure, the inference line for statically determinate beam. And for the light blue beam, you need to know the inference line for the statically indeterminate. Okay. Okay, that is some other example. This one is the precast, pre-stress concrete beam. This one is a kind of statically determinate beam. Okay, this one you can use the knowledge for theory of structure to analyze it. And you also have the elevated highway like this. Okay, and come to what we use to draw is the shear diagram and moments diagram. What the difference between shear diagram, moment diagram, and the inference line? The shear diagram and moment diagram, the diagrams are all based on fixed load. The load have no movement, the load fixed. Unlike the inference line diagram, we suppose the load can be moved from, for example, from point A passing to B and to point C. And we may interested, for example, what's going to be the reaction at A. Okay. And then based on the concept of shear diagram and moment diagram, that's for building. Okay, we assume the load won't move. We think just the load assume all the area in the building and we draw the shear diagram and moment diagram. Okay, unlike the bridge, the load on the bridge from vehicle, the vehicle is movable load. That's the concept of inference line diagram. And recall back to what we have for the Muller-Bessler principle. When we have it in the theory of structure, if we like to draw the inference line, I don't like to read these words for you. Just go to these pictures. When you like to draw the inference line for the reaction at A, based upon Muller's principle, you must release the resistance to A sub Y. Since the pin has the A sub X and A sub Y. When you release A sub Y, the pin still has the resistance to the A sub X. So you will change the pin A to the lower guide. Okay. And since you didn't interested in the B, the support at B the same. Then you apply the reaction A sub Y and move the beam to 1.0 unit. The shape of the beam is now the inference line diagram. Okay. And luckily, this one also applicable to the statically indeterminate. For example, if you just put the support one more over here, okay? And then you use the same principle as the statically determinate. Release the resistance to the A sub Y. And you put A sub Y to move the beam for 1.0 unit. And based upon this, the shape of the beam now is also the inference line diagram of the A sub Y. But this one is IL of A sub Y for statically determinate. But this one also the inference line diagram of A sub Y for statically indeterminate. You can demonstrate this thing very easy. Let me put this one as the beam, okay? And then you have T support, right? You release one of them, you release here, and you put it to one unit. You see the shape of the beam now is the inference line diagram of A sub Y. And if you have another kind of statically indeterminate now, let me put it to be the fixed and roller like this. If you like to draw the inference line diagram of A sub Y of this second statically indeterminate beam, you just put the roller over here. Now you let the A sub Y move this thing. You just put this one, put the A sub Y, put it into 1.0 unit. Now thing just change. Since over here, even though it can move vertically, but it still have the moment resistance. So it's going to be something like this, okay? You just move this one up. You have the shape like this. This one, the inference line diagram of the beam with fixed and roller support, in which this is 1.0. And the shape of curve over here is going to be inference line of reaction of A sub Y. So let's compare them. In short, statically determinate beam will have the straight line, inference line diagram. But statically indeterminate, they always curve, okay, inference line diagram. And then just change to shear diagram. Based on the Muller said, if you like to draw the inference line diagram of the shear force, release the resistance of the shear force. By doing that, you just put the roller, okay? Change point C to the roller, and then go to the static. We have the sign convention for the internal moment and internal shear, okay? On the left portion, the shear force must be downward. On the right hand side, the shear force must be upward. So based upon the sign convention that we have, the left portion will move downward and the right portion will move upward. And then the relative displacement between left and right portion, the sum of them is 1.0, okay? And then if you said this portion is A and this portion is B, sum of them is L, you will have this one minus A over L, this one positive, B over L. And since you can use the similar triangle, if let's say this one is A, you can compute the coordinate over here very easy. It's going to be positive A over L. Okay, this is going to be very simple. And now let me move to the moment, the inference line diagram for the moment. We release the resistance to the moment at C by put the hinge into the beam. And then you apply the moment M sub C to lift this one up. And this one going to move for AB over L. And the shape of this beam is now the inference line diagram of the moment at C. Okay, and one more thing is the relative angle over here is 1.0. This is the review of the inference line diagram of the statically determinate beam. It's supposed to be very easy. And next, when we have the inference line diagram, we will use it to determine what so-called loading pattern. What kind of loading pattern that's going to produce the maximum shear at sea? If we have the live load, this is the live load in the form of point load. There is two types of live load. One is the point load. Another one is uniformly distributed load. This is the uniformly distributed load. Okay, the LLW can be a length in any proper length. And based on the inference line at C, as we discussed on the left, that we take the portion of the beam downward. On the right, is take this one upward, and this one plus B over L. Since B is 7.5 meter, so 7.5 divided by L is plus 0.75. And on this portion, it's going to be minus A over L. And that means it's going to be minus 2.5 divided by 10. And you can see the positive area is larger than the negative area. So the influence of the positive area will be larger. So when you put the load, you got to put the uniformly distributed load on this positive area. And for the point load, you must put it at the maximum coordinate of that portion of the beam. And then you can compute the maximum V sub C. You have the point load. The point load will time the coordinate. The uniformly distributed load, you must time it with the area. Now, this is quite simple. Okay, 4 kilonewton time the coordinate. 2 kilonewton per meter time the area. And then you get the maximum V sub C basis upon this loading pattern very easy. The problem comes when we have the inference line diagram for the statically indeterminate. The graph is not straight line and it's going to be curved. How you are going to determine the area of a function, you got to do the integration, and for sure that's going to be in your examination. Okay, so I will provide you the function. I will provide you the function, but you got to use this principle first. From the function, you got to be able to draw the inference line diagram based upon the function. And then if you have the payload, you got to put the payload at the maximum value of the coordinate. And then you got to put the uniformly distributed load on the portion that has maximum area. It may be positive or negative whatsoever. And then you got to do the integration, okay? I will have that kind of problem later. For the maximum moment at sea, you draw the inference line diagram at sea by putting the hinge at sea. And then the shape of this beam going to be like this. The coordinate at sea is going to be A times B divided by L. It's 1.875. Now, the whole area is positive. So the 2 kilonewton per meter will cover the whole length. And you can see the loading pattern produce the maximum shear at sea is different from the loading pattern when you're looking for the maximum moment at sea. Okay, that's why we need to consider it. And again, the payload times the coordinate, the uniformly distributed load times the area, you get the maximum moment at sea on this beam to be 26.25. Okay, this is the second problem. And then we are going to derive the equation for the inference line diagram of statically indeterminate beam. To be able to find the equation, we got to talking about the Maxwell reciprocal theorem. And if you go to the Professor Hipperer textbook, you may use your mathematics and energy method to prove the Maxwell theorem. But the better way for nowadays, you may use the substructor to prove it, okay? The Maxwell said the deflection at point B called F sub B and the load at A. This is the deflection at point B due to the load at point A is equal to the deflection at point A due to the load at point B. Okay, you may have the beam. Let's say this beam has 1 meter, 1 meter, 1 meter. You put the load 1 unit at A, you measure the deflection at B called F deflection at B due to the load at A. Okay, again, you do the same with the beam. However, the 1.0 unit applied at B, you will measure the deflection between these 2 points, they are the same. When you like inwards, it's going to be something like this. But if you do the substructor, when you put the force, for example, this one, 10 kilonewton, and then over here is the deflection. This one, the deflection at point B, when the load apply at A. And then you do the same with this one, but you put the load at point B. And then this is the deflection at point A due to the load at point B. And you can see they are the same, okay? And this kind of calculation also apply for the moment and the slope. The slope at B, when the moment apply at A is equal to the slope at A when the moment applied at B. So just run the computer program to prove it. Okay, and then you will get the same result. And the last one, is the interaction between the moment and the force. If you put the force at point A, you measure the slope at point B. This is the slope at point B due to a load, a force at point A. Okay, it's going to be equal to this picture. You put the moment at point B, and then you determine the deflection at point A due to the moment at point B. They are the same. Very simple. The index AB and BA can switch. Okay, no matter is it the linear displacement or is the rotational or slope displacement. And that's the principle. Okay, just accept it. You may run the subtractor to prove it by yourself, like I did show you here. Last thing, we're going to review the consistent deformation. Since the inference line diagram now, we concentrate on the statically indeterminate beam. We go back to the consistent deformation that we have in the theory of structure. If, again, consider this one, this beam has the degree of indeterminacy. 4 is unknown and T is equation. This is one. You got to select one as the redundant force. And the best way to select the redundant force for this one is to select the roller at B. We just change the roller to B sub Y. Now, we use the principle of superposition. We have the known force P. This may be 10 kilonewton. And this is the unknown. So we use the principle of superposition based on B sub Y as the redundant. We separate the beam into one due to the known force, 10 kilonewton, and another one due to the unknown reaction, B sub Y. And then we consider the deformation occur. That's why we study the deflection before consistent deformation. And then we have this one for the P equal to 10 kilonewton. And since B sub Y is unknown, we assume B sub Y to be one. We determine the deflection at point B due to the load B sub Y at point B. Okay. Since the unknown is B sub Y, just multiply B sub Y with the known F sub BB. And based on what we have is the compatibility condition at point B. This one, zero. This one, equal. The downward is positive. The upward is going to be negative. And then you can determine the B sub Y. But before you can find it, you got to be able to determine the deflection of the beam. And how can you determine it? You have many methods. First, double integration. That is the first one. Second one, you have the conjugate beam method. The third one, you have what? Virtual work, right? You have the virtual work. And the fourth one, you have the deflection table. For the deflection table, the application may limit to what you have in the table. Okay, but for sure, I recommend you guys to use the conjugate beam to determine the deflection. And I assign you guys to go back and rework it. Next class, I will have some example and I will use the conjugate beam to determine the inference line equation. Now, we review everything. Okay, the deflection, the consistent deformation. Okay, and we are ready to determine the inference line equation of the reaction at point A. First, we just consider the beam and then we put 1.0 load over here. And if you prefer, you may say this is the position measured from the reference A to be X meter. And since this one is statically indeterminate with the degree of indeterminacy equal to 1, and you like to use this one as the redundant, then you have what? You have to change this roller, take it out, and put the A sub Y as the redundant. Now, it's go back to the consistent deformation by the principle of superposition. You separate the beam into two beams. Okay, now the deformation does occur due to the 1 unit load. The deflection at point A due to the load at point D. Okay, this is going to be the first one. And for this one, you apply the A sub Y. Since A sub Y is unknown, you change A sub Y to 1. This is the deflection at point A due to the load at point A. Come to the compatibility condition. 0 equal to F sub AD plus A sub Y F sub AA. And then you have the A sub Y, but is negative. Now, Maxwell reciprocal come to change this negative into the positive. Since F sub DA and F sub AD, they are equal, but in the opposite direction. So when you put it over here, rearrange it, you get this equation. Now, this is the equation, inference line equation of A sub Y. And then you got to change the D to any point X. You get this equation to be the inference line equation. And then based upon this equation, you got to do what? You got to just determine this one. In the step of finding the equation of the reaction A sub Y, you just release the support A and put the A sub Y equal to 1. Okay, the shape of this beam is going to be the shape of the inference line of A sub Y. The coordinate, okay, of the inference line can be determined by divide the deflection by this deflection. So on this one, based upon Musler-Bessler, you release the roller, you apply the force, you move it into 1.0 unit, and the shape of the beam is going to be the inference line diagram. And that's it, okay? And again, if, okay, we have inference line diagram, again, for B sub Y, let me have this is B, this is A, and this is C. You do the same thing. If you like to draw the inference line of B sub Y, keep this one as the pin, keep this one as the roller. You just release the roller here and put the B sub Y here. And then what occur similar to this one, you have this one, and then you put it at the middle, okay? The shape of the beam gonna be like this. Now, the inference line of the B sub Y going to be like this. And this one is going to be 1.0. And the inference line of B sub Y will be the deflection at point X due to the load F high at B divided by F sub B B. See, if you change X to B, this one will be F sub B B divided by F sub B B is this one. Again, if you like to draw the inference line diagram of reaction C sub Y, now you do the same thing. Pin at A, still pin. Roller at B, still roller. You release the roller, you put C sub Y, apply toolkit. And what happened is this one will move to this point of 1.0. And now you do the same thing. You put, you just keep this one. Okay, first you didn't apply the force. When you apply the force, this one will have the shape like this. This one is going to be the inference line diagram of C sub Y. So, this one will have the inference line of C sub Y. And the equation inference line of C sub Y equal to the deflection at point X when the force applied at C divided by the deflection at point C due to the force applied at C. So this all the equation for what you should know. And another kind of problem that we have is this one. If we have the beam with the fix at point A and roller at point B. If you like to find the inference line of the reaction at point A, you just keep this one, okay? You release for the fix, you got to change it into the roller guide. And then this still have the resistance to the moment. Now you apply A sub Y, and then you move this one for 1 unit. What happened is the point A will move to here with 1.0 unit. Now you come to your roller. This one is the roller. This one is fixed. You fix it, you move it. The shape gonna be something like this. This is going to be the inference line diagram of A sub Y of this one. It's changed, okay? But it's gonna keep this one at the right angle. Inference line diagram of A sub Y equal to the deflection at any point X due to the load applied at A divided by F sub A A. Okay. And how about the B? The same thing. You just change this one now. You got to release the roller. However, A still fixed. When you release the roller, you apply this one for B sub Y. Now the shape is gonna be something like this. This is going to be the inference line diagram of B sub Y, and it's going to have the shape like candle beam. And this is 1.0 inference line of B sub Y. F sub XB divided by F sub BB. Okay. And the scope of the examination is going to be something like this. Only beam with 1 degree of indeterminacy for the problem of finding the inference line diagram equation. Okay. And this is going to be important because the inference line diagram for the shear and the moment, the equation is simple, but the way to determine the deflection going to be tough. Let us move to inference line equation for shear force. In examination, I won't ask you to draw the inference line for the shear and the moment directly, because the complexity or the complication of using the conjugate beam to determine the deflection. In the examination, I will ask you to draw the inference line diagram of the reaction, and then use that information with the engine static to draw the inference line diagram of shear, to draw the inference line diagram of the moment. Confused, Ajahn? Don't worry. I will show you next week. Okay. I will show you next week or maybe next lecture. But based on what we should learn, again, this one is the beam with DOI equal to 1. And you like to draw this, you must pick this one as the redundant. When you put this one as redundant, you got to put the roller at point E, okay, because it's E. And then under the 1.0 unit load, the deformation of the beam will be like this. See, it's going to be very complicated to find the equation of deformation of this beam, right? Because the function is not continuous. Function is discontinuous at E. And then by principle of superposition, this is going to be this one plus this one. Now, what we have, we got to concentrate on point E. For the S point E, the relative displacement at this one must be 0. So this is 0. This is equal. This is F sub ED. And this is F sub EE times V sub E. Now, the V sub E is negative. And then Maxwell reciprocal theorem come, change the equation from the negative to positive in this one. And if you just change this one to X, you can see the form of the shear force equation, similar to the reaction equation, right? It's the deflection divided by the deflection. And again, the beam has this continuity. The way to determine the deflection here and here quite complicated. So we got to recommend. I recommend you to draw the inference line of the reaction first, and then use the information and engine static to draw the inference line of the shear. Okay, I will show you. Don't worry. For somehow, one of you may be interested in finding the inference line diagram of the shear directly. You may go to Hibbler textbook, okay? Or in Thai, you may go to my textbook. It's going to be the same. And the last one, we come, or this one prove for the experiment for the inference line diagram of the chair. Okay, they just cut over here and put the rubber band and put the force over here and trying to make the condition over here as given. And the last one for inference line of the moment at point E, you use the moment here as the redundant, M sub E as the redundant. So the first one will be this one plus this one. And then we interested in point E, the relative rotation must be zero. Okay, and then this alpha sub ED is here. For this one, alpha sub EE over here is much time M sub E. Again, the equation is negative. And by the Maxwell reciprocal theorem, we have the relationship over here. And when we change the negative into positive, the slope change to the linear displacement. So the equation for the inference line of the moment is going to be the ratio of the linear displacement divided by the slope. Again, you will have this equation, just change d to x. And then this is the experiment result to confirm on the inference line diagram of the moment. Okay. And I will come later, okay, to draw a lot of inference line diagram of the reaction, inference line diagram of shear, inference line diagram of the moment. Next class, we will do a lot of drawing, and we will write the inference line equation. And I recommend you guys to go to the extra example, okay, and take at least two pages of them. I don't want you guys to draw it on the iPad. You're supposed to have it in the paper, okay, because there is something that's going to be very hard if you draw on the iPad. And there are some conditions I will tell you later. Okay, that's going to be the first problem. Draw this one and put the load pattern onto it. So that's all for today. And I will take the picture of the review of moment distribution and post on the Facebook. Okay, so enjoy your evening, and the score must be posted in front of the room B101. Okay.